Welcome. Thank you very much for joining us for the first episode of YCP's new virtual series, Refiner's Fire. Every month, starting today, Catholic business leaders from diverse industries will share their professional and spiritual wisdom with us, all in short 30-minute live sessions. That's why we're calling this a micro-interview series. In spite of the short length of these segments, we hope that the tips that are shared will be really powerful for all of us as we seek to work in witness for Christ this year. So some of you may wonder, how did we choose the name for this series, Refiner's Fire? Well, it actually comes from scripture, from Malachi chapter 3, where we learn that God is like a refiner's fire who seeks to purify us and make us better. And that's the whole point of this series. Through the professional and spiritual wisdom shared by these exceptional Catholic leaders, we hope that we can improve in small ways in our journey. Topics each month will be really relevant and helpful, like how to manage our relationship with our boss, or how to improve our professional etiquette or executive presence. So let's be open to this journey of refinement so that we can seek that higher standard of excellence that gives glory to God. So our very first topic has to do with being proactive or reactive. And what does that really mean? Sure, we get in that in some circumstances we can be very kind of prepared and ready to take action, and that in other situations we can kind of take a more passive approach, a more "this happened to me" mentality. But what does it really mean in our professional and spiritual lives? Well, I can't think of a better person to speak about this topic than Harry Kramer. Harry is an executive partner with Madison Dearborn Partners, a private equity firm based in Chicago. And he's also an award-winning professor of management and strategy at Northwestern University. Harry is the author of two best-selling books on leadership. And he was also the former chairman and CEO of Baxter International, a $12 billion global healthcare company. Not only that, Harry and his wife, Julie, have 5 children. Talk about someone who has lived a proactive and full life. Welcome, Harry. We're so happy to have you. Thank you for joining us.
It's great to be with you, Jennifer. Great to be with you and the team.
Thanks so much. Well, let's just jump right in.
Good.
So, Harry, I gave you a list of topics, and you actually chose this one, proactive versus reactive. So can you tell us why, as young Catholic professionals, why does this topic matter for us as we're beginning this new year?
Sure. Great. Well, even though I don't know everybody on the call, Jennifer, I'm pretty well aware that everybody has way more to do than time to do it. I don't mean to hassle anybody, you know, on one day here early in the year, but the fact of life is there's probably 3 times more to do than you're ever going to have time to do. And the usual reaction of people that are conscientious like you and the team is, well, I'll just go faster and faster. Okay. And this is where the multitasking kicks in, and I'll just try to do as much as I possibly can. And the question that I come up with, which is the one you asked, which was, have we confused activity and productivity? We're very, very active, but how productive are we? How proactive are we? And I think that ability to take the time to figure that out, and the answer to that in my mind is be self-reflective and prayerful. To take a small amount of time, turn off the noise, turn off the gadgets, get off by yourself, and ask yourself some pretty important questions, Jennifer. What are my values? Mm-hmm. What's my purpose? What is Christ asking me to do? What kind of a leader do I want to be? What kind of example do I want to set in my life as a Catholic? I don't think it's possible to do that if I'm running around doing 10 million things. Mm-hmm. And so that ability to be self-reflective and prayerful, in my mind, opens the door to be able to make a very, very big impact on others.
Absolutely. And, you know, it's funny when you think of that phrase self-reflective, a lot of people think of self-help, but it actually is very much in line with our Catholic faith. Like you were saying, we have to take that time to stop and discern because it really has such an impact on our own lives and the lives of others. So do you mind diving a little bit deeper into that, Harry? So let's talk about being proactive at work. What is that like? And then again, proactive in our faith. And then maybe you can also talk a little bit about what it looks like to be reactive in those areas.
Sure. Well, the way I think about it, and it impacts, I think, my entire life, is that it's very easy at work or in your daily life to think about all the issues that are on. You know, in my company, this is a problem, that's a problem. And the group of people, Jennifer, that we usually assign that are going to solve these problems is this group of people that we usually refer to as those guys. There's some gender-neutral term, Jennifer, but there's some infamous group of people that is going to do it. And I think if you're proactive, the light goes on, and I ask everybody, are you going to be reactive, or are you going to be proactive? In fact, by the way, when we're looking for those guys, have you reached a point in your life where you realize, I am one of those guys. I'm one of the men or women who's going to do something as opposed to waiting for everybody else. Or the other way I sometimes describe it to the Northwestern Kellogg students, Jennifer, as I say, are you watching the movie or are you in the movie? Mm. Are you going to sit around and complain about all the issues or are you going to do something about it? Right. Mm-hmm. And then in your faith life, we all read the same thing, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, well, there's fewer Catholics that go to church, right? Mm-hmm. There's more and more people that are living together without getting married. You know, oh boy, these are all issues. And boy, I really hope somebody solves this. Well, wait a minute. Okay, what are we doing about it? Okay, yeah. I think it's what you're doing and the team is doing by developing young Catholic professionals, right? And if you can get, you know, not just a couple hundred thousand, if you can get millions of young Catholics involved in this, instead of watching the movie, we're in the movie and we can actually do something about it. And so I think a little bit of that mindset of, I don't have to wait for anything. And by the way, Jennifer, very simple leadership model, three words, leadership, influence, the ability to relate. So rather than saying, oh, I'm at a low level in the organization, I can't do much yet, is you realize leadership has nothing to do with titles and organizational charts. Mm-hmm. Leadership, influence, relate. If I can figure out a way to relate to you, I can influence you. And if I can influence you, and I can lead you. So rather than waiting for something, how about getting started and doing something? And I think in our faith, I think people need examples of what a Catholic Christian faith looks like. And if we're not exhibiting that, who do we think is?
Mm-hmm. And so how do we get started? I mean, what specific tips do you have? Because I think that's where people struggle is just that first step, you know? What tips do you have for having that mindset at work and then again in our faith?
Yeah. So I think of it as if I can be self-reflective, if I can take the time to be prayerful to realize what is God calling me to do. Mm-hmm. And then I say to myself, you know what? Through my example, I can have an enormous impact on others. And by saying, you know what? I don't have to stand on a street corner. I literally, through my example of living what God has asked me to do, I can have an enormous impact on people. Jennifer, I'll give you a really good example. I was at a manager role at Baxter, and I would write a little note each month to talk about what was going on. And one time I said, we need to be more flexible. And I told a little story of how I was putting together the nativity for the first grade, that I was teaching the first grade CCD classes. Mm-hmm. And I said, here's a great example. We needed three volunteers, three boys to volunteer to be the three kings. Mm-hmm. And there were like eight guys who wanted to do it. And I thought, well, wait a minute. No, we're going to be flexible. We're going to have eight kings. And I mentioned this in the newsletter. I sent this out. I got over 100 emails from people saying, you know what? If you're one of the managers and you are teaching Sunday school, I'm going to start to teach Sunday school.
Wow.
I mean, so through our example, right? Again, we can talk about things, but there was a great quote, Andrew Carnegie, who was a steel industrialist many years ago, he said, the older I get, the less I listen to what people say, and the more I watch what they do, right? So through our behavior, we can influence people, and I think bring more and more people to Christ.
Absolutely. So, I mean, are there any situations where being reactive is a positive thing? I mean, sometimes it's thrust upon us, you know? I mean, like you were saying at work, if we're kind of at a lower level, we kind of have to respond, but we can still do it in a proactive manner. What would you say about that? Is it always better to be proactive?
So here's the balance. One of my principles, these are great questions, Jennifer. One of my principles is balance, right? Everything in balance. So if you're my boss, I always role play this. If you're my boss and you ask me something, rather than jumping in immediately, I should take a little bit of time. You could call it reactive. I call it just waiting, learning, thinking it through, and deciding, okay, how am I going to deal with that? So let's be real specific, Jennifer. there's a project and you think we ought to go east. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking to myself, you know what? I don't know if east is the right way. Well, that rather than reacting it, I'm going to take the time to think about it. Mm-hmm. The St. Francis comment I say every day, I seek to understand before mm-hmm. I'm understood. I want to know why you think it easy, east. Yeah. I'm going to study that. And maybe I'm reacting. But once I think about it, either I'm going to decide, you know what? Jennifer's right. And the more I think about it, now we're going to be proactive. Now we're going to get it done. Or mm-hmm. wait a minute. You know what? Respectfully, I think it's the wrong way. And can I relate to you and influence you? And now be proactive to take it in another direction. Right. Mm-hmm. So I'm not advocating immediately jumping in. Take mm-hmm. a little bit of time, be a little reflective, be a little prayerful, you know, mm-hmm. figure out what God's asking us to do. And then I'm going to jump in.
That makes a lot of sense. Now, you've said a lot already about being reflective, you know, discerning God's will. And I think that's so important. You know, we have to know ourselves in order to know how we can be more proactive, right? Or situations where we might be more reactive. I'm just thinking of, you know, people like myself who might not be morning people, for example. To be proactive would be to plan ahead the night before. Could you talk a little bit about your own kind of day and how you set yourself up to be proactive during the day? Because as we discussed, you're a very busy, successful man. So what tips do you do during your day in both your professional and spiritual life to be proactive?
Sure. And I often say, Jennifer, I don't have a lot of answers, but I have many opinions. So I don't do Q&A, I do Q&O. But this one, I've got some pretty strong opinions. I had the benefit when I was in school many years ago to go on a three-day silent retreat run by the Jesuits up in St. Paul, Minnesota. And mm-hmm. at the time, I was like, wait a minute, I'm going to keep quiet and say nothing for 3 days? That's not going to work well. But mm-hmm. I did it. And I have to say, you're coming about discerning. Of being quiet, being silent, asking God, what is he asking of us? Yeah. And it was the best 3 days of my life. And at the end of the 3 days, Jennifer, they said, this shouldn't be a one-time exercise. You should do a personal self-examination along the lines of St. Ignatius of Loyola, the spiritual mm-hmm. exercises, and you should take 15 minutes a day. Now, like you, Jennifer, I'm not a morning person. Lots happening in the morning, 5 children, a lot of boards, a lot of teaching. I'm a night guy, all right? Yeah. So what I started doing almost 40 years ago, Jennifer, I take 15 minutes yeah. at the end of every day. For me, it's usually midnight, and I go through a personal self-examination. Mm. I can send you a list of it, Jennifer, that you can pass on to folks.
That'd be great.
But here it goes. What did I say I was going to do today? What did I actually do? Mm-hmm. What am I proud of? What am I not proud of? Mm-hmm. How did I lead people? How did I follow people? If I live today over again, what would I have done differently? And if God gives me tomorrow, based on what I learned today, how will I operate differently tomorrow?
Wow.
And I've done that every day for the past 40 years. Some people say, would you do it every day? Well, Jennifer, if you and I are at a party till midnight, I think we'll probably brush our teeth before we go to bed. It's been a habit. And I always try to write a few notes down. And the thing that most of the students can't believe is that what I ended up doing is I've gone on this 3-day silent retreat, the first weekend in December now, for almost 40 consecutive years.
Wow.
No matter where I am in the world, I do that. Because I almost view it as, and people ought to think about this, you take a day, once a year, whatever, to decide, like in your position, what's my strategic plan? We do strategic plannings for our companies. What's mm-hmm. my strategic plan? And then what's your operational check-in? How well are we doing? How many new members do we have? What can we be doing better? And in my mind, it literally helps me be more productive mm-hmm. and get a lot of things done and to prioritize.
It's interesting. It just makes me think that to be proactive requires a lot of discipline. And I think that that's a term people don't like. but it is really important if you think about it. Our lives are not just for ourselves. You know, we're here for a reason. And that's part of our calling as Catholics, is we kind of have to put in that effort, because God might be calling us to something through these practices of consistency, of discipline, of reflection, and that we might be missing if we're not, you know, sort of discerning his will every single day. So that's great advice, Harry. So I'm just thinking about this world that we're in today. Obviously, a lot of young people are kind of confronted with the fact that there's changes in the government, the virus, there's a lot of stress around financial security, you know, there's challenges in our church. What would you say, in light of everything we've been discussing so far, about how we can be proactive in this world where it seems like so many things are happening all around us?
Yeah, great question, Jennifer. And I think about this, I teach this, I pray about this. Here's the way, I'll build a little model for you. If we're honest, there's a series of things that most of us do a lot more than we wish we did. And I'll put them under the buckets, Jennifer, of worry, fear, anxiety, pressure, and stress, just to name five. And I tell people, what do you know about worry, fear, anxiety, pressure, and stress? And people say, well, it's unproductive. It's not healthy. It takes me away from what I'm really focused on doing. But if you wait until the person has a problem, if I wait, Jennifer, until you have a problem, let's say, oh, Jennifer, don't worry. Well, it's too late. You're already worried. And so what I realized is, wait a minute. One of the tremendous benefits of being self-reflective and prayerful is that it minimizes the surprise. So what I started to do, and this is maybe a little tip, a little practical advice for everybody on the team, Jennifer, I asked myself this question. What am I going to do when things don't go well? When we have all of the chaos that we've got going? And I decided, you know what? I'm going to take a big step back. I'm first going to ask myself, when things are going well, what am I going to do? And I thought, when things are going to go well, I'm going to thank God. I'm going to be grateful. I'm going to thank everybody on the team. But before that good piece happens, I'm going to ask myself, what am I going to do when, not if, when things go down? When there's issues in my family, you know, with my spouse, with my job, what am I going to do? And what I decided, Jennifer, and this is all from self-reflection and prayer, I decided I would do two things. Number one, I will try to do the right thing of what God would want me to do. Now, by the way, I'm not bright enough to figure that out by myself. So I better surround myself with some very good Christian people to help me figure that out, right? That's where the team comes in. That's why YCP is so important.
Yeah.
And the second thing I'm going to do, we will do the best we can do. Now, I'm summarizing this, Jennifer, because I do this like in a three-hour lecture at Kellogg. But here's the deal. If I can convince myself that no matter what happens, and I mean no matter what happens, the insanity in Washington, you name it, I'll try to do the right thing. I'll do the best I can do.
Yeah.
I'll try to do the right thing. I'll do the best I can do.
Yeah.
Worry, fear, anxiety, pressure, and stress can be significantly reduced. They can never be eliminated. And God's always challenging us, right? But we put that in a perspective. And it has an enormous impact on how we live our life. There was a student who said to me, well, Harry, you know, how seriously do you take this? And Jennifer, this may sound a little morbid, but I don't mean it that way. I'm a pretty positive person, as you know. But here we are. We're having this discussion, and it's a Tuesday. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but what's the worst thing that could happen to me tomorrow? I'm pretty confident the worst thing that could happen to me tomorrow, God forbid, something happens to Julie or something happens to one of my five children. Now, I hope it doesn't happen. I'll pray it doesn't happen. I'll do everything I can to prevent it. But if it happens, I do know what I'll do. I'll try to do the right thing. I'll do the best I can do because I think that's what God's calling me to do. So this ability to put things into perspective, right? Oh, my goodness, I'm in COVID right now. I can't see my grandparents or, you know, my little baby. I love to see them to my mom and dad, but I can't get these are all difficult things.
Right.
But you know what? It's a challenge. We're called to deal with a challenge. And this life is so temporary. We're all hopefully preparing ourselves for eternity. So we'll do the right thing. We'll do the best we can do.
Absolutely. And, you know, it really requires a lot of hope to be proactive, like you said, because we have to be trusting. And at the same time, we have to put in the effort. So it's not just kind of passive surrender. It's a trusting posture, but it's also ready to take action and kind of collaborate with God. So anybody listening, please, it's time for live Q&A coming up in just a moment. So please be posting your questions for Harry. Just really quickly, Harry, while we gather some of these questions, quick answer, what is your wish or challenge for the young worker today as it relates to this topic?
I guess my challenge, my hope, Jennifer, is exactly what you're building in YCP. I'm hoping people become more proactive. I'm hoping people decide, rather than, you know, well, I'd like to be proactive, but I'm waiting for those guys. No, realize you are one of those guys. God has asked you to be one of the men or women of faith that's going to make a difference in a world that truly needs that.
Absolutely. It's that call to action. Well, this has been a wonderful conversation, and I'm excited to see some of the questions. So let's see the first one that we have.
Good.
All right. The first question is from Michelle. How do we shift from a national individualistic mindset to an attitude of cultivating community?
Yeah, and I have to say, Michelle, it's an environment right now where I think all of us, you folks, can really help a lot. Because right now, and I will tell you, you're mostly younger than I am, I have never seen a period in history where things are as polarized as they are now. And one of the reasons they're so polarized, and I go back to that St. Francis comment, is that we have this problem of that people are not seeking to understand other perspectives, right? Mm-hmm. So what I encourage folks to do is make sure that you understand more than your side of the story, okay? If you happen to be more conservative, great, but do you understand why the liberals feel the way they do? Mm-hmm. And as we all know, and I'm sure you see it, Jennifer, we've gotten ourselves with social media in this trap of echo chambers where people only hear what they want to hear, and they don't have any understanding why. And the answer to most things is somewhere in the middle. And yeah, if you don't understand what other people think, you're going to be incapable of getting things done. So if we're going to really build a community, we need to be respectful and understand people, and then hopefully guide them to more what God would ask us to do.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And also remember that, you know, we were founded as a nation under God. And I think God is the grand unifier. So I think, you know, like you said, Harry, about making time for our faith. I mean, I think that's one of the best things we can do, because then we will be better people. We'll be less selfish, less prideful, and then more able to respect others as well. So
absolutely.
Thanks so much, Michelle. Let's see what's next. All right. From Allison. Harry, how do we balance quiet silence and hearing God's calling with productivity-obsessed secular world?
Yeah, great, great question, Allison. So I look at it, as I look at everything, as a balance. It's a balance, okay? If I don't take a period of quiet silence, really thinking through what is God asking me to do, it's very hard for me to be productive in a positive way. And the fact that the secular world is as crazy as it is, and just this constant talking about materialism and all this going on, I think we can better deal with that as leaders and setting an example if we've taken some time on our own with some fellow Christians to actually think through, okay, how are we going to deal with this mess? And how can we be proactive about it? But it's got to be a balance.
Absolutely. It's hard to achieve it. Thanks so much, Allison. Let's see who's next. Matt. How do you balance being proactive and doing your absolute best while at the same time not projecting your will over God's will?
Ah, well, perfect, Matt. And that's exactly why two things need to happen. I need to spend some time in self-reflection and prayer, and I've got to find a group of very strong Catholics that I can think through, does this make sense? Am I really doing what God's calling me to do, or have I gotten my ego in the way, Matt? Am I doing something because that's what I would like as opposed to what God would like? So that combination of self-reflection and literally finding people, and that's why this YCP is so important. I can't do this myself. There's no way I could do it myself.
It's true. The people we surround ourselves with almost become our reference point and kind of help us remind us who we are and if we are kind of veering from that straight and narrow. So it is so important to have that community. Absolutely. Thank you so much. All right. Let's see. We have another question from Andrew. How do you help your employees who may be feeling stress and anxiety in both the workplace and the world?
Yeah, super question, Andrew. And it's particularly relevant given what we're going on in this COVID now, because obviously, I mean, I wish I was in the same room with all of you right now. We could all be together. We mm-hmm. could have a drink together. We could hug one up. But given this situation, I think there's a tendency to withdraw. I'd be isolated. And what I would encourage you to do is make sure you're spending time with your team members. Okay. Again, this is far from perfect, but this virtual presence is much, much better. I'm a lot older than you are. 20 years ago, you could do this with one other group and the screen was backing back and forth and there was a delay. The fact you can get hundreds of people on this, mm-hmm. What I'm doing on every board I'm on, I'm calling people, and it's not just work related. It's how are you doing? Mm-hmm. How's your family doing? Should I be praying for you? How's your grandfather doing? How your young babies doing? How do we support one another and demonstrate that we care one another and can get through this whole isolation period? Now, we'll get through all of this, I'm confident, but it's going to take a while. All right. And one of the unfortunate things that's happened is we've got into this crazy period of, oh, it'll be over by Easter. It'll be over by the election. No, this is go. Trust me, being in healthcare for 40 years, this is going to go on for another at least 8-9 months. But yeah, we will get through it. We'll definitely get to the other side. But we have to pray for it. We got to be hopeful that we get all the vaccines we need. But putting it in perspective and taking care of one another in the meantime becomes absolutely critical.
Absolutely. I think it's a call to action for us not to kind of be so transactional like the world is and really kind of make that time to show people we care. Absolutely. We have time for one more question. This went by so quickly. Yeah. All right, let's see if we have one more. Allie, how can we be proactive in advancing your career amid all the companies hiring, promotion, raise freezes, rather than just waiting?
Yeah, so I feel strongly about this one. What I would do, and I recommend, is do two things. One, do the best possible job in the job that you're in, and at the same time, volunteer for projects, volunteer for other things. Tell folks, hey, I know I'm in marketing right now, but are there some projects in the finance department? Or is there something I can be doing in production? So demonstrating the fact that you're not just looking at yourself in one silo or one function, but you're willing to take a look and get out of that and be able to volunteer for many projects. And then I think you have a chance of getting noticed of the difference that you can make to the organization.
Such good advice. Thank you so much, Harry.